God loves me, loves my colour, loves my culture, loves my history, loves my people, and wants to redeem them.
Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world.
It's now hip to go to church.
Can I get somebody to shout glory?
God is black. Who else could God be?
Somebody shout glory in him. Somebody shout glory in him.
Amen.
Glory.
Amen.
Mercy.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Sing it over.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Celebrate Jesus.
Roac Ministries in London is one of 3,000 black-majority churches in Britain, the fastest-growing area of Christianity in the UK. Set up in Brixton 9 years ago, this evangelical church began with only 18 people. It now has more than 3,000 members.
Roac Ministries is a church that is on the move. Our vision is to have 20,000 people. We definitely are growing to the point that I'm like saying, Lord, now we have to look for a bigger building.
And Roac is not alone. It is one of many black churches rapidly expanding. And this growth is even more remarkable given that church going, in general, is in steep decline in Britain. The evangelical wing of Christianity, both white and black, is more successful at attracting new members, but the growth in the black churches is much higher, and it is not restricted to the evangelical churches alone. Today, more than half of all churchgoers in London are non-white.
Black majority churches have been the fastest growing churches in every major denomination over the last 20 or 30 years and beyond that.
I have news for the devil. The church is about to rise. The church is about to rise. You can keep your buildings. We're still going to rise. You can keep your halls. We're still going to rise.
Black churches in Britain have seen a phenomenal upsurge in members, and this looks set to continue. Their story is one of success, but their origins tell another story of rejection, hostility, and struggle in the face of adversity. It's a story which started 50 years ago.
The Empire Windrush brings to Britain 500 Jamaicans. Many are ex-servicemen who know England. They serve this country well. In Jamaica, they couldn't find work. Discouraged, but full of hope, they sail for Britain, citizens of the British Empire coming to the mother country with good intent.
They came to Britain to build a new life, but they didn't expect to have to build a new religion.
We were brought up with the picture of England as a mother country when it comes to religion. And because some of our early planters of churches were English, we thought that we're going to come to a country where there's religion is wow. But it was not.
Many of those who came to Britain from the Caribbean in the post-war era came from a strong religious background. In fact, many belonged to the Anglican Church. But in the mother country, they found religion didn't have the same prominence as back home. On top of that, the established churches, which they had such high regard for, were all too often cold and unwelcoming.
A very large number of people had come both from Africa and the Caribbean, having been brought up as were Church of England Christians, Anglican Christians, expecting to be welcomed in the churches and so on, and were somewhat surprised to discover that they were not immediately welcomed.
The first place I went was to the Baptist church on the Colorado Lane. Why? Because we had known a lovely minister in Kingston, was at the Baptist church, and we thought, well, he would be, this one would be the same as the one we know, but it wasn't so. They greeted you, but as I said, their body language told you that you did not belong there.
There are many, many, many stories of people being asked not to come again, being not spoken to, or being recommended to the church down the road because that's where you people go.
Fidelia Onyuku Opakeri came to Britain in 1967 to join her husband. Coming from religious families in Nigeria, they were keen to attend church in England.
We sat down and everybody on the pew left the pew where we sat down. Well, I didn't know what was going on because I never knew anything about racism before. It was only my husband who knew what was going on. And then during the Holy Communion, we went up for the Holy Communion and everybody else left the front of altar, of the altar where we were kneeling for the Holy Communion. It didn't mean anything to me until after the service when the vicar was shaking hands at the door. He whispered something to my husband, which I later learned that he said, oh, we should go and find our own type of people because he doesn't think this place is suitable for us. So when we came out, my husband started telling me what was going on. I said, what was that? He said, racism. I said, what's that?
The rejection encountered in churches was shocking, but it mirrored the racism and resentment in society at large.
No blacks, no dogs, no Irish, no blacks. All the signs put up, yes. On. No blacks, no Irish.
The church, to some extent, reflected the general ignorance. In addition to the ignorance, there was downright racism.
We were brought up as very strict Christians, and therefore we very much depended on God and praying. So to be rejected in the church was a very heavy blow.
It meant, really, that to some extent the Anglican Church lost a generation of young black Christians.
This world is not my home. I'm only passing by. My treasures and my hope are all up in the sky. My friends and loved ones wait who trod this way before, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh, Lord.
Rejected by the established churches and desperately trying to cope in a new country, many people started setting up their own places of worship, but often found it hard to find suitable premises.
We were worshipping in a sitting room just like this, gathering, just as house prayer, really. That's what I would call it. At the end of the day, the place was getting so full. People were sitting on the stairs and chairs outside, so we decided to go and look for a hall. So that's the way it started.
Prepare your hearts for the Lord.
When we began, we sat into a front room. And most of our churches sat in the front room, our basement.
Beside how we sit, where we walk, and what we do. And when God doesn't start to move, we can't feel God, because our God is no address. But let's forget our God.
Melvin Powell continued to hold services wherever he could.
I approached a particular church that I knew have a very big hall. So I went into the caretaker and said, I'm looking for a place to establish, to start our service, prayer worship. And he said to me, sir, if you want a place for a party or for a wedding, it's available. But for church, No, sir.
Sing it tonight, I surrender all. Come along tonight. Maybe a young man tonight.
Like many of the early black churches, the New Testament Assembly had to move around, holding services in community centres and town halls.
We grew it out, sometimes we don't know how we're holding there. But the Lord led us over to Glen Burnie Road, where we bought our first building in this area in 1965. And in a short 2 years, we couldn't hold. So we keep moving on.
The New Testament Assembly continued to move on and grow in numbers over the years, eventually becoming one of the most successful and established of the original black churches. There were several denominations to which the early churches belonged, but most of them grew out of Pentecostalism, a charismatic movement which believes in the power of the Holy Spirit and in being born again through adult baptism.
The churches that were established were not completely new. They have their origins in the Pentecostal explosion in the early part of the 20th century in North America. The birth of Pentecostalism occurs in 1906 in Azusa Street, Los Angeles, and it becomes an incredibly dynamic, prolific denomination which splinters and splinters time and time after again until 1915, you have almost 100 different Pentecostal denominations. These denominations then end up in the Caribbean in all their various complexions. So when we're talking about African-Caribbean Christianity in Britain in the 1950s, we're looking at a whole plethora of denominations and splinter groups from those denominations being established.
It's not rooted in books, it's not rooted in systematic theology. It's rooted in experience, it's rooted in encounter with God. It's rooted in feeling the Holy Spirit. And it's that felt salvation and that felt reassurance of the power of community that had a great redeeming force for people taken from their native cultures.
There's an argument that Pentecostalism is at its best amongst migrant groups of people. So when people are entering a new situation, strange land, hostile territory, Pentecostal faith thrives. And I think to a degree this is what happens with Pentecostalism in the 1950s. It's a faith that enabled people to adapt from the old country to the new country. It gave them a sense of peace, direction, stability, and also the possibility of networking with like-minded people.
Not all churchgoers coming from the Caribbean and Africa left the mainstream denominations. The Pentecostal movement wasn't for everyone.
I enjoyed going. I enjoyed mainly the singing and the enthusiasm that people had. At the Calvary Temple, but it wasn't for me. I think the Anglican Church is very different. It's quieter, and when that's what I was used to, the contemplative silence and the peacefulness of prayer. I didn't get that with Pentecostal Church, but I get that here.
But for a black person, worshipping within the Anglican Church isn't always easy, even today.
When you come into an Anglican church, it feels very white dominated. Not only, you know, there's mainly white people that come here, but also the images that are around the iconography and all that sort of stuff, it doesn't reflect, to me as a black person, that this is somewhere welcoming for me to come to.
And in those days of the civil rights struggle and the murder of Martin Luther King, we thought them so racist, unlike us in England, as most people, or most white people here, still naively thought.
Racism is rooted and endemic in white British consciousness. You don't expunge the legacy of 1,000 years in 5 minutes. Getting beyond goodwill to look at structures and justice and equality. Look around a church and see if there is any black iconography there. See if children are given black images in their Christian education, how they picture Jesus in their heads, all that sort of thing always has to go on. And it's a long and ceaseless struggle.
I think there's a lot of work that still needs to be done. There still aren't, a strong presence of black people in positions of power.
Of around 125 Anglican bishops in Britain, only two are black. And many black clergy find that the synod, the decision-making body of the Church of England, is disproportionately white.
I sat in General Synod's opening service, and I was amazed. Of the over 500 members of General Synod, I could count maybe up to a dozen black people walking in the procession. And a little part of me felt ashamed to be part of the Church of England when I see that. So the leadership is almost entirely white. Very few black people in leadership within the church.
Within the Catholic Church in Britain, there are about 5,000 parish priests, but less than 30 are black, a much lower percentage than there are black members of the congregation. There are no black bishops, archbishops, or cardinals.
When I was ordained, I was the first person of West Indian background to be a Roman Catholic priest in Britain, which is frightening. It's frightening for the church, it's also frightening for me because the expectations on you are so high. But it shows that something is not quite right when in 1991, after so many years of African Caribbean people being here, I was the first person to be ordained a priest.
Although the mainstream churches have acknowledged the reality of racism, they are now facing the problem of attracting black people.
The Church of England is saying to black people, well, come on, we want you. A lot of such people have lost interest and have gone away.
If people aren't moved and touched, then, you know, they don't want to be a part of it. When we're on the cricket pitch or when we're on the football, you know, stands, look how loud we cheer and yell. And yet we come to church and we sit so still, perfect. Can't even move. You get a hymn with rhythm and people sort of stand stiff as ever, you know. So that's a major challenge, I think, making sure the worship is inspiring.
Good morning, welcome, good morning.
You find a lot of black people who would say that they go to another church, even though some of them would come to a Catholic church, they still go to another church because they feel a greater sense of welcome. And for somebody from a Caribbean background, they like things to be a little bit more open, a little more friendly, and then they come to a church and they don't find it. And so they go to other churches where they say they're among their own people. And in that sense, they feel more welcomed. In that way, they tend to celebrate a lot more.
Real. Right, so. Hold on a second. I got some dignified people sitting at the back of the congregation, all looking all sophisticated, trying to look around like they're some important people. I want you to just for a second, just get out of your little important cell for a second. Get your hand together, find a tambourine, get the other hand to meet the other hand, get your feet to meet the floor, and let's have some church in here, amen? Everybody stand to your feet.
Celebration is an essential part of the service in any black majority church. It's a defining trait.
You don't just sit in church on Sunday and listen politely. You participate in the service. You express yourself physically, verbally.
When we talk about a black Christian faith in Britain or the dynamics that occur in black majority churches, there are some essential distinctives. First of all, in the way people understand and relate their faith and their relationship with God.
So Lord, for the benefit of your people, give me a word, Lord, and let them understand what you're calling them, the purpose, in Jesus' name. Amen. Somebody shout amen.
Black Christians hold Scripture as the final authority of God. There's a big emphasis on Scripture. So you wouldn't find within black majority churches leaders who believe that the Bible is just another book which we can take or leave whichever bits we don't like or which cause offense to anyone else. They take the whole counsel of God or the whole Scripture as it is and give it a very significant value.
When I come to church, I come to hear good news. I need to know. Now, listen to me. Talk to me about hell. Talk to me about damnation. Talk to me about how my heart needs to be clean. And talk to me about righteousness and holiness. I need to hear that. But when you finish, let me know that at the end, there is good news.
The issues of heaven and hell is very, very real to black Christians. Or else they would see it as no point of being Christians. And that motivates the way they respond to mission, the way they believe that everybody has to have an opportunity to avoid this horror of hell and embrace this, the joy of being part of heaven.
Can I tell you what the Holy Ghost did in Acts chapter 2? When he came down, he gave you the badge, gave you the authority, and said, whatsoever you're bound on earth,
we always say in the African Caribbean church tradition, if you can preach well, you get a congregation.
You can go into a haunted house and say, devil, get out, I bought this house.
The preaching is crucial. The preacher is seen as a man or woman of God. The preacher is seen as somebody who is in constant communication with God and therefore can communicate the message to the people.
One of the things the Lord began to speak to me about, he says, John, my people have become so relaxed because the church is packed. And we feel that there is no need anymore to really go out as a church and reach the lost. So for the next couple of weeks, he told me to bring the church back to evangelism.
There are several features that can be identified in terms of the style. The first one is call and response. That is where the preacher will say, for example, can I get a witness, or hallelujah, can somebody say hallelujah or hello if the congregation don't seem to be falling asleep, or and then the congregation will respond in kind.
Somebody holler Jesus in here.
It's a very African way of communicating, and that really is one of the most important and unique aspects of black preaching style.
Look at somebody say, I know something, I know something. I know something. What you know is what others don't know. They see you and they see something on you. Look at someone and say, it's on me.
Then you have repetition. We see, for example, in Dr. Martin Luther King, we see repetition where he repeats, "I have a dream," quite a number of times. And that is really done so that the audience will remember the key points of a sermon or a political message.
In Jesus' name. Somebody say, "In Jesus' name."
You have what's called the hooping tradition, where the preacher sings and talks at the same time, and the music is in the background, often the organ, that will play at the same time as the preacher is preaching. So it sounds very poetic.
You know, music is a universal thing. It breaks down cultural barriers.
Gladys Knight wrote the song, "If Anyone."
You know, sometimes before I preach, I'll end up singing for ages and people just love it. When you start to sing, even if they don't understand you, they feel it and they hear it and they like it.
Between each line of pain and glory, look at somebody and say, "Jesus is the best thing that could ever happen. Oh, Jesus is the best." I don't know who Gladys Knight was speaking about, but we're there. I wonder if I got a witness. Jesus is the best thing that ever happened to me, that could ever happen to me. All right, is there anybody in here? Let me sing it one more time.
The Black Christian experience would not be what it is without the music. It's an important part of the service. It helps set the mood, but it's also important in terms of the young people.
If the question's in your heart, now hear me out. Did you know that love can be so true? I've never ever been the same since I found you. But did you know that eternity can do this? No circumstance that never brings a weakness. What love? Whose love? That's the question. Now listen to this with attention. Come check it out, come. We are eternity. We're
doing this. Eternity, an inner city Birmingham band, is one of many young groups based in the Black Church. Like others, they have been encouraged to bring their own musical style to the gospel message.
The music in the church provides an outlet whereby young people can channel their energies and their talents. A lot of the major developments in gospel music come from the younger generation.
The music that we're playing, which is gospel music, it's a very, very important part, because without music, I don't think that messages will be getting across.
Young people are very much influenced by the music of their secular counterparts. So whereas before, ministers might think that, you know, reggae was evil or hip-hop was evil or rap was evil, today they're finding that it's very popular, they're getting a following for it. So they're just open to all kinds of music. They're not closed. They're quite broad-minded when it comes to utilising music to spread the message.
If you had a teenager coming off the street and say you heard "Clap Your Hands," "Side to Side," tambourines all over the place, they'd think, "Nah, this ain't for me," and they'd probably walk out. Now, if they heard, you know, like, they came in and they heard, like,
True Love,
which we play, and they listen to it, and they'll think, "Yeah, yeah, I like the beat," they'll come in and they'll be listening to the beat. But they cannot help, no matter what happens, they will not be able to stop listening to the words.
Usually you'll find, when you find a Black dead church, it's because the music is dead. If you find the music alive, anointed, testifying, and giving testimony to the Lord Jesus Christ, you're going to have your church filled. So it's very central to the service. I would think that no pastor in this hour would dare think of, of what the Lord wants to do to grow his church without having a real viable music ministry.
But gospel music also has a deeper significance for black Christians.
Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows but Jesus. Nobody. The trouble I've seen, oh glory, hallelujah.
Brought to America as slaves, the descendants of today's African Americans were not allowed to read or write, so they clung to the strong oral traditions they had carried with them from Africa. This was the root of gospel music.
The slave song is very unique. It's probably the only song birthed out of persecution that testifies to its faith. Many of them are other folk songs, but this is not necessarily a folk song. This is a testimony of their faith.
They were not permitted to practice their own native religions from Africa. They were not even permitted to speak their languages. So the issue emerged as to how were the slaves going to find meaning in a world that did not acknowledge them as human beings.
The slaves found the meaning for life within Christianity. It offered them a spiritual freedom denied to them on earth.
All you have to do is read the Bible. You read it, and it there, you know, it talks about freedom and dignity, and it talks about love and justice. Slaves heard that. So the slaves embraced the message because it empowered them. And one message in it that it embraced a great deal was what we in theology call that eschatological dimension. Well, the normal way of saying it is heaven.
When Israel was in Egypt's land, let my people go.
I think what they took from Christianity was an identification with Jesus. Jesus, the suffering servant, who ultimately, even though whipped and beaten and crucified, was raised again from the dead and triumphed over all the powers of evil. There was also, of course, a very strong identification between the black slave community and Israel in Egypt. And one only has to listen to the great spirituals to realize that powerful sense of identification with, you know, God's people in bondage, under Pharaoh, in Egypt, and how, by the hand of God, they were brought out of slavery and into freedom.
To let my people go.
They also related, I think, particularly to the concept of the Second Advent, that Jesus is coming soon. And if Jesus is coming soon, you can have a revolutionary imagination, because Jesus is just about to come. And the high and the mighty and the powerful and the oppressors are going to be brought down. And the poor and the oppressed are going to be exalted, not because they're poor and oppressed, but because they're the sons and the daughters of the living God. If you believe that, and you believe that that can happen any moment now, maybe tomorrow, Jesus will come, then you can have that revolutionary imagination, even in life-denying circumstances.
Go down, Moses. Let my people go.
As well as taking strength from their faith, the slaves used their religion in other ways to help in their fight for freedom.
In the field, there was like a real code. It was a community. They were picking cotton, they were chopping tobacco in the hot sun and things from sunrise to sunset. But they would sing. They could pass their messages on by singing their messages to one another. So if they knew that maybe the freedom, Underground Railroad people were coming through to take some of them to come north, they would say, steal away, and they'd pass it down the line. Steal away. The next one, steal away to Jesus. And then steal away, and until it got around to the field, there's something going on here. Or Go Down Moses could then again be another coded song, and the idea was to give really explicit instructions on what time to go, where to go, and whether we were going down, going up, or just how this was taking place. They stayed scriptural because that was the cover for it, but everyone knew what they were talking about. So it was very exciting to when you think about how ingenious that was.
It's more than 150 years since slavery was abolished, but the spiritual songs the slaves sang remain a large part of African American worship. The legacy of slavery has not been forgotten.
Grace Baptist Church in Mount Vernon was formed in 1888 by five former slave women. We started out with five women, and today we're approaching 4,000 members.
From the days of slavery, black Christianity in America has had a political dimension, and as its congregations have grown, so has its political power and influence.
Even though the Bible, none of we can quote it from Genesis to Revelation, we know all the books of the Bible, but it's nothing important until that religion has gotten you and kicked you up and turned you around until it has transformed.
It's a church that has always had a real social consciousness in terms of advocating on behalf of the community. I don't know if that's because of this former slave beginning or just the role of the African American church in the United States of America.
And you can have an encounter this morning, won't you come? God bless you, sister. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you, young lady.
The church is vital to the African American community. Without the church, African American people would be voiceless and would have very little institutions. All of our institutions have come out of the church. The colleges that we have, the African American colleges that have come out of the church, our political officials have come out of the church. The civil rights movement had its beginning and was sustained by the church. The Voting Rights Act movement was sustained by the church. And today, the degree in which economic empowerment is happening is also participating by the church.
What is your name, my brother?
Carlos Lawrence.
Are you member in the church, Brother Lawrence?
No, I'm not.
You ever been baptized?
No, I have not.
You want to be baptized?
Thank you.
The black church has been where African Americans have been able to come to become affirmed when the culture has denied their value or has discriminated against them or put them down. The church was always the place where they could come and have affirmation. The role the black church plays is not just simply
eschatological theology. It's more existential engagement, and that's what keeps the church alive. It keeps the black church relevant and meaningful. So as long as racism is a reality in America, we will continue to have the need, and the black church will continue to exist.
I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream.
The great strength of the black churches in the U.S., the majority churches, the black-led churches, is their deep, profound understanding that you can't be Christian without embracing justice.
My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
Justice is at the heart of the Christian faith. Justice in the society, in the community. That's what King tapped into. That's why he could inspire black people. You just don't suddenly arouse a large masses of people without something being already there that you can touch. And King was a middle-class black. He had very little connection with the masses of the people to whom he spoke. But that connection that he did have was their faith, which he got out of the black church too, Baptist. And he knew how to talk about that faith in such a way that it embraced justice and put justice at the center and helped black people to realize they could not be Christian unless they did march in those streets, unless they did rebel against segregation.
When all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
There's always been a radical political tradition within black faith. You can go back to the 18th and 19th century and find slaves and free slaves articulating a form of political theology from their context. That radical voice stayed within the church within North America. So consequently, political theology has found a home, if an uncomfortable one at times, within mainstream African-American Christianity.
As well as the civil rights message preached by Martin Luther King, there were other, more radical voices urging a new black consciousness. The most important of these belonged to Malcolm X.
Malcolm X helped us to realize that we could not be who we are as a black people without affirming blackness. So he taught us what it means to be black and that we could not be human beings without being black.
There's no such thing as freedom in this country for a black man. There's no such thing as justice in this country for a black man. And there's no such thing as equality in this country for a black man. This is a white man's country.
Now, Malcolm chose the Nation of Islam, the Muslim, and he called it a black people's religion. What we wanted to show is that you could be black and Christian at the same time. But King did not emphasize blackness. He emphasized justice, and he emphasized the beloved community, where we all one without regard to race. But we lived in a society that was defined by race, in churches defined by race. So King was working against a great odd. And Malcolm's critique forced us young black theologians and ministers who were deeply involved in the civil rights, struggling for justice, but not emphasizing blackness. Malcolm persuaded us that we could not be Christian unless we reinterpreted the faith in such a way that embraced our blackness as well as justice. So I am a Christian like King, but I'm black like Malcolm.
Being black and Christian is not a contradiction. It's actually an exciting combination. My faith helps me to make sense of being black, and it helps me to make sense of it by affirming who I am. God loves me, loves my colour, loves my culture, loves my history, loves my people, and wants to redeem them. God even goes as far as to say that if we were the only people on earth, he would still have sent his son to redeem us.
Black theology re-examines Christianity and its relationship with racism. It attempts to express the meaning of God from a black perspective.
Black people throughout the world are generally at the bottom of any economic ladder, generally the most oppressed people in any society. They are usually at the bottom. Now, God is always identified with who is at the bottom. So God is black, not in a literal sense. Jesus is black, not in a literal scientific sense, but in a symbolic sense, in a mythological sense. That is, in the sense that we say God is love, in the sense that we say God is a God of justice. I will say, in a world that regards blacks as nothing, that mistreats black, in that world, God is black. Who else could God be?
Despite the achievements of the civil rights movement, America is still a deeply divided society, and the fight for justice and equality remains at the forefront of the black church today.
Martin Luther King's base was the black church. That's why his organization was called the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. When Reverend Jesse Jackson ran for president, his base was the black church. What I've been doing the last decade has been based in the black church.
Reverend Al Sharpton, one of the most well-known black leaders in New York, has run for mayor, been in prison for various demonstrations, and founded the National Action Network, a civil rights organization.
And we need someone that's sensitive to people that are upper class, middle class, and lower class in the economic strata.
The self-styled people's preacher combines song and prayer within weekly political rallies.
The most victims of crime are we that are poor. We just don't want to have to run from the cops and the robbers.
The black preacher in America is supported by the people. He's free to talk, nobody has any strings on him, and the church is a free agency. The independence of the church is a critical thing. So the church has been able to be an advocate politically. Most African-American mayors, if you were to ask around the country, they would tell you that they were owing their elections to the role of the church.
You know, Jesus' challenge was not to just have ceremony, but he said, I was hungry and you didn't feed me. Naked, you didn't clothe me. Outdoors, you didn't take me in. So it is the will of those that we say we believe in that we do more than just have some ceremonial one day a week kind of involvement. And you cannot help people if you're not involved in politics. So the church has, in my judgment, no choice but to be politically involved.
African-American style of worship has clearly come to Britain. But along with the gospel choirs, the cameras and the razzmatazz, will the churches also adopt the political role taken on by their counterparts across the Atlantic? If it's going to happen, you'd expect a church like Kingsway to lead the way. Set up in 1992, it has grown to a congregation of 8,000, making it the fastest growing church in Europe.
We're only 9 years old. We have another two branches outside of this area of London. We have one church overseas, and we're on television in several parts of the world with a potential audience of over 200 million, and we believe we'll grow. We have some strategies for the new year. Matter of fact, it's our vision to create what we call a spiritual wall of fire around London. In the new year, in January, we'll be opening 40 Sunday chapels around London.
Set me free!
So with such potential for growth and power, does the leader of Kingsway have political ambitions?
Certain men of cloth, certain clergymen may want to be involved in political offices, but I don't think I'm one of such. I even consider it as stooping down. I feel that this is a high calling from God to be doing what I'm doing. The moment you declare your commitment to one party, you are immediately thought to hold a certain opinion against another party, whereas a minister of the gospel should really be representative.
It could be a family thing I mentioned tonight. Your marriage may be struggling. Come, I'm waiting for you. Just come.
And the reluctance to get involved in politics seems to be shared by other church leaders.
You know, I'm called to preach. I am not a politician as such. I can speak. I'm blessed in that area. But I really believe what I'm called to do is what I do best, what I'm doing now, preaching the gospel.
There are some who believe that this lack of political ambition within the black churches in Britain does not make the most of their potential and that they should play a far wider role.
There are those like myself who would argue that Jesus was deeply political and that many of his actions were political actions. Therefore, we as Christians today also need to engage in the world on a political level. What's tended to happen within the black church in Britain is that they've opted for a non-political or apolitical approach to reading the Bible. As a consequence, they've not seen the teachings of Jesus in a political way and not acted politically.
When I came to Britain in the early 90s and we had rallies at the Friends House and other places, the churches were afraid to get involved. And you can't preach faith and then have fear of the political powers that be.
I want you to lift your hands up tonight and just cry to God. I want everyone in this premises, stretch your hand to everyone in front of us and begin to pray for yourself and say, He restores my
soul. But while they may not take a political stance as such, black church leaders in Britain are well aware of their power within a broader social context.
Currently, within the black community, the seat of influence and power, the seat of what you might call a political voice, is within the local church, within the church community. So I think that for the future, if anyone really wants to reach certain communities, so that they are not ghettoized, it might be important to involve the spiritual leadership of such community.
The important thing is to be a voice that all parties can turn to. Jesus said that we must be in the world, but not of the world. He said the government will be upon his shoulder. I really believe sincerely that we have the power to mold and make things happen. And we need to be a voice reaching out. They're getting out in the community.
One of the ways they get out into the community is to tackle local welfare problems. RUAC sends outreach teams to patrol the Brixton streets, helping the homeless.
Come out, we've got some food. We usually bring out some food at the fountain. Are you all right?
As well as praying for their salvation, they give food and offer counselling to the needy.
We believe we're a church of restoration, and we pick up the people that are hurt and bruised. If you're ministering in an area, if you have a church, you need to reflect the area you're in. The church has to do much more than preach. We have to also reach the people at their need.
Marcy, I'd like you to just lead the prayers. If we can all hold hands just as a sign of unity.
even as they step into these doors tonight, Lord. I pray you will begin to solve some situations, solve some problems. Father, you know the lonely heart, the broken heart, the sad heart, the heart that is shattered, that has no dreams. Lord, those who have drug problem, alcohol problem, homelessness and other situations, oh God.
Churches such as RUAC may not be overtly political like their American sister churches, but at the heart of their outreach mission is a shared theology.
I do think that the future of Christianity is with those who are powerless, with the weak. But Christianity is the religion of the little people, the voiceless people, the people that the world has turned its back on. That's where the future is. It's because most black people are in that category that I would say the future of Christianity is partly black, but it's not exclusively black. The future is exclusively with the poor, the weak, and their struggle for justice in the society.
A large number of those helped on the street joined the church, becoming members of RUAC's ever-expanding congregation.
How are you glad that you're in the house of the Lord today?
Once you start meeting people's needs, then they can't help but come to the ministry. They can't help but feel there's a hope.
In the name of Jesus, Brixton shall be free. I break the spirit of drugs. I break the spirit of death. In the name of Jesus, we take the...
But it's clear that their phenomenal growth is not just down to attracting the powerless. People from all walks of life are finding something here. Like many other black majority churches, RUAC has found a powerful voice within its own community. In fact, it has been so successful that it is struggling to find room for its followers. A lesson, perhaps, for the many white traditional churches which are struggling to fill their buildings, struggling to keep Christianity alive in an increasingly secular society.
Bring Jesus to the 21st century. Let them understand the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. And I think once the mainstream established churches of our country start looking at these things, and start looking at what's the need of the people and start meeting them at their need, then you'll start to see a change. Other than that, if they don't, we the charismatic people are going to be having more and more services.
The loss at any cost.
Born out of immigrant communities and often out of the experience of racism, black majority churches aren't just here to stay. They are beginning to change the face and perhaps the future of Christianity in Britain.
That Brixton